Well, I was asked to say a little bit about some Oregon-specific data and to talk about treatment plans when it comes to marijuana here in Oregon. I also speak as a person in long-term recovery. I haven't used any alcohol or drugs for 29 years, going on 30 years here. Some of the numbers, and then I'm going to tell you a little bit about recovery from marijuana addiction. So Oregon ranks fourth in the U.S. for recent illicit drug use, ages 12 and older, from the National Survey on Drug Use in California. And actually, we've been one of the top 10 drug-using states in America for over a decade now. Drug use really started to escalate in 1999, and drug use really went up after 9/11. Oregon is sort of anomalous because Oregon is one of a handful of states where drug use actually went up after 9/11. Most states in the U.S., drug use went down after 9/11. Here you see between 2002 and 2004, that's really the meth epidemic, and then things started to chill out for a little bit for a few years, and then we went into the opiate epidemic. But Oregon has had sustained long-term heavy drug use for over a decade. This is looking at recent marijuana use in ages 12 and older. Oregon ranks fourth in the U.S. for recent marijuana use. We rank sixth in the U.S. for recent marijuana use among ages 12 to 17, teenagers. And for a sustained period of time in the National Survey on Drug Use and Health, we've had rates higher than the national average, going all the way back before 2003. Now, we are becoming a big alcohol state. So for a long time, probably a good 20 years, Oregon has had drug abuse higher than the national average. We've been one of the top 10 drug abusing states in America for over a decade now. But for a long time, we weren't ranking real high on alcohol abuse or alcoholism. And now we're turning into one of the top alcohol states. We now moved up to ninth for recent alcohol use, and we're also one of the top 10 states for alcohol dependence based on the percentage of the population. So we're becoming a sort of all of the above state. About 40% of Oregon's marijuana citations are given to young people 20 and under. And in the state of Colorado, we've actually seen an increase in public use citations. So when we're thinking about marijuana in youth, we can probably anticipate that we're still going to be seeing citations for young people in the state of Oregon. Now this is more specifically looking at treatment populations. And this is looking at Oregon treatment admissions, 1992 to 2012. Of those with an eighth grade education or less, nearly 40% are marijuana primary treatment admissions. So about 28% of Oregon's treatment admissions are for marijuana, but 40% of those with an eighth grade education or less are marijuana primary treatment admissions. So they make up a disproportionate number. So you heard Kevin talk earlier, and he was saying, you know, yes, if somebody is like really super smart and you shave off 8 IQ points, you know, it may not have a huge impact on that person's life. But if a person is of an average IQ and you shave off 8 IQ points, that's going to have a dramatic impact on the person's life. A third of Oregon treatment admissions who began using at age 11 or younger reported starting on marijuana. And that was really my story. Marijuana was one of the first drugs that I ever used, and I started using when I was 8 years old. I got sober when I was 19 the first time, and that was after a little brush with the law, an experience with the criminal justice system. And I don't have any regrets about that. I'm actually thankful about that. And you can talk to a lot of people in recovery who are actually grateful for their experiences with the criminal justice system because it actually saved their lives. I was fortunate, I was able to go to treatment, and I was able to get into recovery. And I've sort of dedicated my life to recovery. Now, Kevin told you a little bit about changes in marijuana that have happened over the years. So, natural marijuana, and that's what it looks like over there on the left there. I don't know if some of the younger folks in the room may have never actually seen natural marijuana before, but that's what it looks like. It's brown and it has seeds in it. And it runs in a ratio of about 1% THC to 1% CBD. Then we have the strongest marijuana ever confiscated in U.S. borders in Vista, California, that came out to about 37.2% THC. And as Kevin pointed out, THC is increasing in most commercial marijuana, while CBD is remaining relatively low. There are some exceptions to this. There are some types of marijuana that are out there that are higher CBD forms of marijuana that are in the market. Those are usually offered by medical dispensaries. But it doesn't make up the overwhelming majority. The overwhelming majority of marijuana that's out there is high THC, low CBD. Why is this important to understand? Because CBD has been shown in a number of studies to have some strange antagonistic effects, meaning that it can actually block receptors and prevent THC from connecting to receptors. Here we have an axon terminal on one brain cell going off that way, and we have the dendrite receptors of another brain cell going off this way.
I'm gonna grab a microphone.
So, oh, that's louder. What's the laser button? So we have natural brain chemicals that are manufactured inside the axon terminal of the brain cell going off this way. And these natural brain chemicals, you've probably heard of some of them, like endorphin, epinephrine, norepinephrine, dopamine, they are released into a space called a synapse or synaptic gap, and then they attach to these protein receptors on the adjacent cell. These are the dendrite receptors. These molecules, these natural brain chemicals, attach to these receptors and essentially pass messages from one brain cell to the next. You've probably heard of endorphin. Endorphin is a natural chemical produced in the brain. It attaches to endorphin or opiate receptors. When endorphin plugs into this receptor, ka-chunk, it diminishes the feeling of pain that we experience. Endorphin is our body's natural painkiller. Opiate drugs can fit into those same receptors. In fact, that's how most psychoactive drugs work, is that they look like chemicals that already exist inside the human brain. Many, many studies have now shown that when you introduce a chemical into the brain that looks like a chemical that already exists inside the brain, that your brain can start to compensate. It may compensate by producing less endorphin. It may produce less receptors as a result of you introducing this sort of mirror image-like chemical in the brain. In fact, that process starts to occur within 72 hours. So there's a chemical in your brain that looks just like delta-9 THC. It's called anandamide. Anandamide was discovered by Raphael Mishul at Hebrew University back in the 1990s. If I take this every single day, my brain may make less anandamide and receptors for anandamide. This is how most psychoactive drugs work. They look like chemicals that already exist naturally inside the brain. Here we have a CB1 receptor. The CB1 cannabinoid receptor is sticking out of the cell wall. Anandamide can come in and plug into the receptor and activate the receptor. If I use marijuana on a regular basis, it will overactivate the receptor. Three studies have now shown that chronic administration of THC leads to reduced anandamide production in the brain. So that's not super compelling, but more compelling than that is that over 30 studies have shown that chronic administration of THC leads to CB1 downregulation. So CB1 is the name of these receptors. When these receptors downregulate, They basically just grow shut. Overstimulation, overactivation of the receptor causes the receptor to basically slide down into the cytoplasm of the cell and make itself become unavailable. This leads to the dreaded condition of tolerance. Tolerance, the need to use more to get the same effect. And as a person who's a recovering pothead, I can tell you all about tolerance. So yes, it's true, I got sober a long time ago, and marijuana was significantly weaker when I was using it in the 70s and in the early 1980s, but I still experience tolerance. So alcoholism 100 years ago is pretty much the same as alcoholism today. It's not any different. So yes, marijuana was weaker back then, but I still had all of the same symptoms. So when I started smoking marijuana, I would buy marijuana from anybody. I didn't care what it was, I would just buy any marijuana. But as I began to experience downregulation of these receptors, I started to get picky about the marijuana I bought. I wasn't gonna buy just any marijuana that was out there. I would look at it, I would smell it, I would examine it. If I could smell it through the plastic, then I knew, okay, this had to be good. Because my fear was, I was gonna buy some marijuana and I was gonna bring it home and it wasn't gonna get me high because it didn't have enough THC in it. So I got super picky about marijuana, and then I started smoking more marijuana, and then I started smoking hash, and then I started smoking hash oil. And eventually, my tolerance got so bad that I started taking tea breaks. That's what we call it. That's what potheads call it, tea breaks, which is a tolerance break. So I would tell my friends, I'm gonna quit smoking weed so my tolerance will go back down. And I would say, I'm gonna quit smoking for a week, or I'm gonna quit smoking for 2 weeks. And I rarely ever made it more than a day or two. Usually within a day or two, I would be back at it, and I would start smoking marijuana again. But that was my intent. So this all falls in the category of addiction independence. So what we're seeing in treatment is just a much faster progression, especially among adolescents. And a lot of adolescents are now using some of the more concentrated products, like Keef, which is often 30-35% THC, and BHO. And BHO, I'm not sure what the average is, but I suspect probably the average for BHO is probably around maybe 75-80% THC. But as Kevin said, there are higher proportions on that. That's a lot, and that produces a faster progression. BHO is, and I'm not even sure why they call it butane honey oil, because it's not really oil, it's really the resin of the plant. Back in my day, when I was a pothead, we actually did smoke oil. Oil was the solvent that was used to extract THC out of marijuana. Now it's butane gas. So this is probably more accurately described as BHR, butane honey resin. So people dab it out, people smoke it, and it's made out of high THC, low CBD marijuana. Now, Kevin told you about Sativex, but one of the things that he didn't really describe about Sativex in its 1-to-1 ratio is that the overwhelming majority of test subjects that were in the clinical trials in Europe and Canada reported that when they sprayed this stuff in their mouth all day, they said that they felt nothing. Nothing. They didn't feel high, they didn't feel stoned, they didn't feel baked. So how is that possible? Half this bottle is THC. People are spraying it in their mouth all day. How is that possible that they're not feeling high, they're not feeling stoned? Well, that's because of the presence of CBD. Sativex has a chemical profile of real, true, natural marijuana. So my concern as a person who works in treatment and as a person who's in recovery is really the commercialization of marijuana. This is what I'm most concerned about. When I look at our treatment populations, people that come into alcohol and drug treatment in the state of Oregon and really in the United States, most of the industries that produce recreational chemicals, the tobacco industry, the alcohol industry, or recreational behaviors like gambling, their life's blood is not the average user. Their life's blood is the addict's. If every person 21 and older in this country drank alcohol according to the recommended federal guidelines, which is no more than 2 drinks a day for a man and no more than 1 drink a day for a woman, if everyone 21 and older drank according to those recommended guidelines, alcohol sales in America would drop 80%. The industry would be devastated. The lifeblood of most of these industries is not the occasional user. The lifeblood of most of these industries, like the tobacco industry, is that, do they make their money off people who occasionally smoke? Is that where they make their money? No, they make their money on people addicted to cigarettes. And in more recent years, studies have revealed that state lotteries and video poker, where do they make the biggest portion of their money? Well, that's off what they call the loyal customers. The loyal customers. And that's sort of a euphemism for people that are suffering from gambling, abuse, gambling addiction, pathologic gambling, whatever you want to call it. So that's my concern, is just the gross commercialization of any of these products, any of them. Thanks.